The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. Once upon a time, they were the proud queens of the seas, till the airplane and a swifter tempo of life chased most of them to the dry docks. Still, a few remain, for nothing can quite replace the sumptuous ease and romance of a trip by sea. Most are cruise ships, but some dauntless ladies are still ocean-going liners. So, will you join me in an ocean voyage? Although I can't promise you that this one will be as restful as most. First, I find the light. There. Now, I carry you across the threshold.
I hope I'm not too heavy.
Light as a feather.
Watch it, Jim!
What?
There's a man! Oh!
Oh! Look out, Mary. I'm falling. You all right?
Yes. Who was it?
Somebody broke into the cabin.
Oh, no. He acted like he tried to kill us.
Our mystery drama, The Bittersweet Honeymoon, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Ian Martin and stars Jada Rowland and Russell Horton. It's sponsored in part by ARM, Allergy Relief Medicine, and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. The beginning of a sea voyage is an excitement that cannot be matched by any other form of traveling. The people who are already aboard line the rail. The officers and crew in their crisp dress uniforms, the vibration from generators below, the urgent message of the ship's horn, everywhere the ring of voices. Well, it's an experience to be cherished and never forgotten, especially if you are sailing from Naples, Italy, and you have been married less than 3 hours, and you are young.
Excuse me, Mr. and Mrs. James Shelton.
That's right.
I'm Mr. Braithwaite, the chief purser. I wonder if we could have a little chat in my office.
Why? Is something wrong?
Not wrong. No, nothing wrong. Just something irregular and unfortunate.
Oh, Jim, I hope it isn't my passport.
Well, they said at the embassy everything was in order. Mr.
Braithwaite.
Braithwaite, yes. Well, we do have the wedding certificate and all the papers.
Oh, there's no question of that. After you, please.
But we're just about to sail.
If we're going along.
You don't think...
There we are. Now, that's better. Won't you sit down and let me explain?
You've got us on pins and needles, sir.
Well, Mr. and Mrs. Shelton, you should have no embarrassments. It's the shipping line that has to face up to that. I have an apology to make to you.
I don't understand.
An unfortunate mistake was made when you booked your cabin. It is not available. It's already occupied.
Oh, no.
You mean we can't sail with you?
Well, there are no other accommodations.
But we're on our honeymoon.
We just got married.
The Mansard line would be most happy to get you a berth on a later ship or some other line.
Well, that's no good. I can't get back home later than next Monday. I'm starting a job.
Ah, well then, the office is ready to help book any plane, flight, first class.
Well, that isn't the same. Like, the only reason we got married was so we could go by ship. I mean...
Well, you see, we got this crazy notion that the best honeymoon we could have would be shipboard, so...
You don't know what we went through to cut all the red tape and make the marriage possible.
Yeah, and the papers picked up the story. The press services are all wiring it back to the States.
We're going to look like a couple of fools.
you say you've received some publicity? Well, I didn't realize you were quite so famous.
Well, we're not really. It was just kind of an accident the way it happened.
It wasn't an accident, Jim.
Well, you see, Mary Jane had just graduated from college. She's a music major, and just for kicks, she was a contestant on What's That Title?
On what?
What's That Title? It's a TV game show.
Yeah, and she won.
A lot of kooky things I didn't exactly want or need. A car and this trip to Italy.
That's how we met.
At the Villa d'Este, halfway down the hill.
Yeah, I was in love with her from the first moment I saw her. Well, I was over on a trip my dad blew me to after I got out of law school and before I went to work. Well, I had more time than Mary.
2 weeks more.
So she wired home for some more dough. She decided not to go home till I did.
But I still had this return ticket. So we went out to the airport to try to cash it in. But they wouldn't, of course. Only this little nun.
This little what?
A nun. Oh, a dear little lady. She'd been saving up all these years to take a trip to America to see her sister. Somebody picked her pocket. Or took her pocketbook or whatever nuns have.
Yeah, with all her money. So Mary got this swell notion, and she managed to sell the airline on the idea of letting the nun use her ticket.
Well, there was this big man with a cigar listening to all this, and everybody was yakking about it.
So Signor Fratelli, that was the big man with the cigar, he went round and took a collection from all the other passengers waiting for planes and got enough for her passage back and some money to spend in New York. So that's the way it happened.
What happened?
Well, this publicity representative for the airlines wrote up a story about it.
I told him because we were going to get married, so we could have our honeymoon the way both of us had always dreamed.
By boat.
The SS Queen Victoria. And this was her last transatlantic crossing before she became a cruise ship.
It was kind of a drag in some ways.
But pretty good publicity for your shipping line.
Yes, it was, wasn't it? Well, under the circumstances, I feel it is up to the Mansard Lines to make an adjustment. On second thought, I think I can find you accommodations.
I thought you said there weren't any.
Well, not in tourist class. As a matter of fact, there are very few people in the world who could afford these particular accommodations.
What do you mean?
Well, now, we had a last-minute cancellation from the Shah. Well, the country is not important since he wished to remain incognito. But I'm sure that you will like the suite.
Suite?
Oh, yes, it's quite extensive as well as expensive. We call it the Royal Suite.
The Royal Suite.
How do you like it, Mrs. Shelton?
Oh, it's fabulous.
Priceless.
Almost. For this one crossing, this suite costs $21,000, or if you prefer, $3,000 per day. Fresh flowers, of course, are included. Well, enjoy your honeymoon.
You mean it's all ours? Just like that?
It's all yours.
Gee, how can we ever thank you, Mr. Braithwaite?
Don't thank me. Thank your lucky stars and whoever fouled up in our office when they booked you.
And the fact that, well, we happen to be a little bit in the news.
Gee, I just can't believe the way we've lucked out.
Well, we've cast off, so you must allow me to send up a bottle of champagne with your bags to say bon voyage. And, of course, so you can toast each other and your good luck.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Can you believe it?
Oh, I must be dreaming. I just hope I don't wake up.
Me too. As long as I'm sharing the dream.
Well, that'll take forever. A whole lifetime.
Oh, Jim, I love you so.
Mary, I love you.
What a way to live.
And what a way to die.
Jim.
What?
Well, what made you say a thing like that?
Oh, honey, it's just a thing to say. Hey, don't let it get to you. What is it?
Somebody walked across my grave. Another thing you say.
What's the matter with you, honey?
I don't know. I'm scared to be so happy and so lucky. What was it Lord Byron said? Whom the gods love, die young.
Magnificent sight, you know?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
And exciting, and breathtaking.
See Naples and die. What a place of beauty this whole harbor is. You are Americans.
Yes, Jim Shelton. This is my wife, Mrs. Shelton.
How do you do?
I am Enzio Abruzzi. Allow me to shake your hand.
Oh, sure.
No, Caesar.
I didn't see your dog.
He is always with me.
Oh, he's beautiful. I have a German shepherd just like him at home.
I hope he won't be jealous when he finds he has a rival.
A rival?
Your new husband.
Oh, how did you know we were newlyweds?
Does it show that much?
It was a guess, but not too hard, eh? There is so much youth and so much love in both voices. Surely you cannot have been married long.
Less than 4 hours.
3 hours, 42 minutes, and 8 seconds.
Ah, mirabile. You must allow me to buy you a drink to celebrate. Perhaps now.
Oh, no thanks, sir. We have some champagne back in our cabin.
And we haven't even unpacked.
See, Caesar, my dog is telling me that the light is going and it is time for his dinner. So perhaps after dinner tonight or some other time.
It's a long voyage. We'll look forward to it, sir.
Bene. Scusatemi. Arrivederci.
Arrivederla.
Ah, you speak Italian.
Of course, così.
We shall try next time we meet. Basta, Caesar. Mangiare. You lead the way.
Oh, he's blind.
Shh.
He kept talking about seeing things.
Only in his mind's eye. Or he remembers. You can see, he can't see.
I was wondering how he could have a dog on board, but... Well, that's why he's blind. It's, getting pretty late, darling.
Oh, let's stay on deck and look at the moon just a little longer. Please, Jim?
Okay. But you do realize we still haven't really unpacked.
Oh, who cares? By the time we finally got the bags and fished out something to wear to dinner and guzzled up the purser's lovely champagne and ate and danced and came out here to romance in the moonlight, well, oh, darling, I wish this night could go on forever. The whole trip.
It will. This is only the beginning.
I wonder where that nice Mr. Abruzzi went after dinner.
Probably to his cabin. That's it. It's cold out here. Time to get back in.
You're right. It's time to go in.
I should have left a light on.
Who needed it? With the moon.
It's just gone behind a cloud.
Can't you find the door to our stateroom?
Well, if I can't, I know my wife has cat's eyes. Oh, here we are.
Ladies first.
Uh-huh. First, I'll find a light.
I carry you across the threshold.
Oh, my darling, it's all such heaven, such rapture. Here we go. Watch the bulkhead.
The last thing I'd ever do is drop you.
Are you out of your mind? Who are you?
Jim. Jim. He acted like he wanted to kill us. Who was that? Jim. Oh, good Lord, you're bleeding. What happened, darling?
What happened indeed? This honeymoon idol has been rudely shattered as Mary and Jim surprised an intruder in their stateroom. A prowler? An enemy of either of them? An assassin who still thought the mysterious Shah was the occupant of the royal suite? At all events, an inauspicious beginning for a honeymoon. We'll see how the rest of it turns out when I bring you Act Two. And Mary Shelton had surprised a mysterious invader in the sumptuous royal suite aboard the SS Queen Victoria, a set of staterooms that became theirs by what seemed to be sheer happy luck. Now knocked to the floor by a fleeing criminal, whoever he was, Mary kneels by her unconscious husband.
Jim? Jim, darling, can you hear me?
What happened?
I don't know. There was someone here in the cabin. Oh, darling, you're bleeding.
I must have hit my head on the corner of the table. Hey, he knocked me over.
Don't try to get up.
Where'd he go?
Out, on deck.
He may be armed. Let me close the door.
I'll get it. Please, honey, just stay there a moment.
Okay. I am a bit woozy. But get the door.
I will.
Boy, that was a whack. Mary, what are you waiting for?
Shh.
Honey, will you get the door closed and locked?
Yes, Jim.
Honey, what were you waiting for before you closed the door?
I heard something.
What?
It sounded like Mr. Abruzzi's cane tapping. Now, let me have a good look at you. Oh, thank heaven. It's just a scratch. I'll get some water and...
No, never mind that. Now, did you get a look at the guy?
No, not really. How about you?
I had you in my arms, and he came from behind the door and knocked me over before I could even turn my head.
What do you suppose he was looking for?
The crown jewels, I guess.
The what?
Face it, baby, we've got nothing could interest a thief, so it must be someone who didn't know the Shaw wasn't here.
Of course. And I thought we were so lucky.
Hey, cheer up, Mary. Once the whole ship knows the Shaw isn't aboard, no one's going to bother us again.
How can we be sure they do?
Simple. Just call Mr. Braithwaite and make sure the word gets around.
What do you suppose Mr. Abruzzi was doing up on our deck?
It's a free ship. He has a right to promenade anywhere he wants.
But so late at night, in the dark?
Hello? Yeah, I want to speak to the purser, please. No, I mean the chief purser, Mr. Braithwaite. Yeah, well, I'm afraid you'd better disturb him. This is Mr. Shelton speaking, and it's urgent. I'm calling from the Royal Suite.
Ain't you?
Gino.
Si.
Where?
Behind the ventilator funnel.
Good. I can stand with my back to you in case anyone comes by. So, what happened?
It was no problem to get into the cabin. But I could not call you because...
Because what?
It was occupied.
What?
Yes. Fortunately, whoever it is, they were not there. But as soon as I saw the bags and some clothes around, I put out the light fast.
And you left unseen?
I hope so. There were some young people on the deck.
Who?
I don't know. Americans in love talking about the honeymoon. I was waiting for them to pass. But instead, they came straight to the suite.
And?
I had only time to step behind the door.
They saw you?
I don't think so, but he was carrying her in his arms as they entered. That was my chance. I pushed them both aside and ran out.
You think they recognized you?
I don't think so. It was too fast. But if the place is occupied, what now do we do?
I don't know. Somehow I must gain access. I must think. In the meanwhile, in case you are recognized, it is all the more reason that there must be no connection between us.
We should not meet again.
I think not, Gino. Unless I send you the sign.
You're sure that you could not recognize this man?
Well, I didn't see him at all.
Mrs. Shelton?
Well, I...
Did you see him?
Just a glimpse as I was falling.
Enough to identify him?
I don't think so.
Well, did you see what he was wearing?
Well, yes, I have an impression that he had on a white coat.
A tuxedo or a steward's coat, perhaps?
Oh, it's so hard to say.
A ship's uniform or a waiter's jacket.
I honestly don't know.
Well, I'm only trying to narrow it down, whether it was a passenger or a member of the crew.
I realize. But I didn't see clearly enough to tell you.
Well, never mind that. The important thing is, what was this guy after?
Well, I can only assume that it was something that belonged to the Shah. Well, as I said, he wished to remain incognito. So let us say the man who originally booked the Royal Suite.
Jewelry or something?
Probably.
You know, it could be a heck of a lot worse than that. Maybe he wanted to assassinate him.
Oh, Jim.
Take it easy, Mary. Look, Mr. Braithwaite, I'm afraid these honeymoon accommodations have turned kind of sour. We want out, or I mean off this boat.
Oh, dear me, that would be most difficult. We don't stop at any other port.
Well, we're not out of the Mediterranean yet. You could call ship to shore for a boat to pick us up.
Well, of course I could, but I really don't think that is necessary. The little incident of tonight will never happen again.
How can you be sure?
Because once everyone on board knows that you are in the suite, there will be no cause for any more incidents.
But how are they going to know?
Because I'm going to give a party for you, a honeymoon party. By tomorrow morning, the ship will be blanketed with notices and announcements on the closed-circuit radio and the public address system.
I don't want a party. We just want to be alone.
Well, in these palatial apartments, you can always be alone. But think how nice to have 1,000 guests and the entire crew celebrating your marriage.
I don't care for myself.
And then
but
think of the other side.
What other side?
Well, now, if I let you leave the ship, I would be party to a crime.
Mm-hmm.
There is a thief aboard, someone guilty of at least breaking and entering, and I want to find that thief. No, no, stay aboard and keep your eyes open, and if you can recognize him, help me to apprehend him, please.
Well,
I have tried to do you children a favor. Do me one in return.
Mary?
It's the least we can do.
And I promise you, you will be guarded around the clock. You can spend the rest of this night in peace.
Well, I could settle for that. So far, it's been some wedding night.
Good morning, Mr. Shelton.
Morning, Mrs. Shelton. You have never looked lovelier.
Thank you. And thank you.
What's the second one for?
That's for not adding to your compliment some piece of male chauvinism like, and it took you long enough.
Did it take you that long to dress?
You mean you didn't miss me?
It didn't seem that long at all.
Why, you... Or maybe you're not putting me on. Why were you staring out the window so intently? Another woman?
If she is, she's a lot more than one man could handle.
What do you mean? Why, you can't even see the pool from here.
Yeah, I was looking at the rock.
What rock?
Gibraltar. We've burned our boats, all right.
Oh, come on, Jim. It's been two whole days. Two wonderful days in our palace and on deck in the sun. Just the way we'd imagined it. I've forgotten all about that first night. What made you think of it?
No, I guess because tonight's our party.
Well, it was very sweet of Mr. Braithwaite. He certainly lives up to all his promises.
Mm. He's a funny, prissy little guy, but he's an all right Joe.
Well, we've got a lot to thank him for. All this.
Sometimes all the munificence scares me.
Why?
Well, no struggling lawyer like me is going to be able to support you in the style to which you're becoming accustomed.
Don't you ever kid yourself. This is just icing on the cake.
Hmm. Speaking of cake, it's like almost noon. How about breakfast?
Sure.
Well, aren't you hungry?
Oh, of course. I was just looking down on the fantail there.
At what?
Signor Abruzzi, walking with his dog. Oh, he's so lonely, always prowling around the ship. He scarcely talks to anyone.
Well, hey, cheer up. He's talking to a deck steward now.
Let's see if he'll have breakfast with us, Jim. Would you mind?
Oh, of course not. Although after buying us all those drinks last night, we're probably the last people he wants to see. Talk to.
He's a beautiful dog, senor.
Yes, steward. I don't know what I'd do without him.
It's all right to talk, Ezio. We are alone on deck. You sent me a signal?
Yes, Gino. Tonight, there is a party for the two young people, you know.
The whole ship knows.
This is our chance. Can you get the key?
Why, still, I have the one from before.
Maybe you should give it to me and let me do it.
No, Ezio. If you get the call, you have no excuse. With me,
I am a crew member. I can always say the door was open. I was just checking the cabin.
Too bad you did not say that the first time.
Yes, that was bad. It was so unexpected. I thought no one was there.
I shall excuse myself early from the party. You will call me in my cabin when you are sure it is safe, and I come immediately.
Good. The moment I see you leave, I'll watch it. The young couple is coming. You sure you don't want a chair?
No, thank you, Stuart.
Morning, Signor Abruzzi.
Ah, who is that? My young friend, Jim Shelton. No.
Me and my better half. Mary and I were thinking if you hadn't had breakfast...
It is so late. I have already eaten.
Maybe it's just as well, Jim.
Well, what is it, honey?
I'm feeling a little sick. Could you take me back to the stateroom?
Oh, sure, darling, but...
I am so sorry. But the sea is a little rough today. I hope you will be all right for the party, Mary.
Oh, sure. This is nothing. Just, will you excuse us?
Of course. I hope you feel better soon.
All right, honey, you want to lean on me?
Yes, please.
Well, how did you get sick all of a sudden?
I'm not sick, Jim. Not like that. No, keep going. Don't stop.
What is it?
The deckhand who was patting the dog. Did you see his hand?
What about it? What hand?
The right hand. He has no little finger.
I didn't notice, but so what?
The first night, the man who broke into our cabin, his hand on my arm as he shoved us off balance. I didn't remember till now. It was missing the little finger.
Jim Shelton is staring at his wife in a kind of dismay. Is her memory accurate? Will the rest of their trip be a nightmare of sworn statements, being involved in investigation instead of relaxation and enjoyment? But for their decision and the surprising results, we'll have to wait till I return shortly with Act Three. A long brunch, but not quite the leisurely one that the Sheltons had planned. Mary's accidental identification of the man they had surprised in their stateroom the first night aboard has faced them with an uncomfortable decision. Seated in the dining saloon of the ship, they are still thrashing it out.
At least I'd like to pop him one for that crack on the head I got because of him.
Oh, Jim, don't you think I'd like to get even with him for that, too? The trouble is...
What?
I'm not 100% sure, really. It's more an impression.
If you saw it, you saw it.
I think I saw it.
Honey, there's a heck of a lot of difference between having four fingers on a hand instead of five.
Please try to understand, Jim. Getting bowled over like that, knocked down in your own... Oh, it is like our home for this little while. It really gave me a jolt. It's a nightmare. Besides, he is a deckhand. Maybe he had a right to be there.
In our stateroom?
He could have thought it was empty.
Well, then why did he have to act the way he did?
Well, he might have thought we could make trouble for him, losing his job.
Mary, face it, he might have been a terrorist about to plant a bomb to blow the Shah of whatever it is into the Muslim paradise, whatever it's called. You want a nut like that running around loose?
Oh, I guess you're right, Jim. Let's go see Mr. Braithwaite.
But, as you say, you are not absolutely certain that a finger was missing from the hand that pushed you.
Well, I'm pretty sure I'm right.
It doesn't leave us too much to go on, does it?
Well, I guess it doesn't.
Well, it would just be my word against his.
Oh, now, come on. Don't look so glum. If I locate him, you don't think for a moment I won't shake him up all I can. And that he's not going to be watched like a hawk every moment of this voyage. I can promise you personally that this man is not going to get away with anything.
Oh, I feel terrible dumping all our problems in your lap, Mr. Braithwaite. I guess we both do.
Oh, now, don't give it a thought, Mr. Shelton. I don't want
want one solitary thing to interfere with you both enjoying your party tonight.
Well, that's another kind thing we have to thank you for.
Well, as it turns out, it may be the high point of the crossing. And I wish by now you would call me Cyril. I'm sure I think of you as Mary and Jim.
It'd be nice to be on a first-name basis.
Oh, yes. Cyril.
So, there we are. That's all solved. Now, all we have to do is look ahead to tonight and your party.
Cyril. How do you do, Cyril? Good evening, Cyril.
Honey, I'm in the shower. I can't hear you. What'd you say?
Oh, honey, I'm just trying out our sponsor's name. Dear Cyril.
Hey, look, it's a man's name.
Oh, don't be stuffy. Hey, it's getting late, and you've only got as far as the bath towel.
10 more minutes, I'll be a sartorial masterpiece, but how about you?
Oh, now that I've finished my face, the clothes take no time.
How could you improve that face?
You get away from me, husband.
Why should I? It's legal.
And with you, it's lethal. You get me under your spell, and we'll never get to our own wedding party.
Yes?
They just left, Enzio. Coast is clear.
I will be right up, Gino.
Better I don't wait. I'll be lookout.
Caesar and I will take care of the rest.
Hold it. Right there. Don't move. Put your hands up.
Senor Braithwaite, I can't see you with a flashlight in my eyes.
So if you can't see, you'd better be sure I have a gun in my hands. What are you doing here?
I was passing the door. I thought I heard a noise inside. I know the senor and the senora were at the party.
All right, you can save the lies. Tell the truth or else.
Or else what?
I can have you put in the brig for breaking and entering. Or just shoot you out of hand for the same reason.
I don't think you'd risk that.
Why not? This isn't the first time you've broken into this cabin. I will only be protecting the passengers against a common thief.
You would be making a mistake. I am not a thief. I am Sergeant Gino Mascara of the Naples Police.
Turn around.
Why?
Don't ask questions. Turn. Unless you want me to shoot.
You know, honey, we should have used the elevator instead of these deck stairs.
Well, I had to get a little air, Jim.
You're getting your hairdo blown to a fare-thee well.
I don't care. Let's just stay here, outside for a moment.
It's your party. If you want to keep them waiting.
I don't want to. It's just... Oh. If only the boat would stop rolling. Oh, I can't face a dinner party feeling like this.
Mary, you seasick?
I guess so.
Well, come on over to the rail.
No. I want to go back and lie down. Just for a moment. Oh, I can't tell you. All of a sudden, I just want to die.
I'll fix that, baby. I got some pills in the stateroom that'll settle your stomach. Come on, let's get back there fast.
I was a fool to turn my back on you. You can't get away with it.
Why not? I'm an officer of this ship with the right to carry arms. You're breaking and entering, and not for the first time.
You couldn't prove that.
As it happens, I can. Because you're missing one finger, you're easy to identify, as Mrs. Shelton already has done.
And if I turn to my back, you think you can knock me out and dump me over the side? Even the weather is cooperating with you, but it won't work.
What do you mean?
We really know too much, Braithwaite. You see, we have interrogated the member of the Shaw's entourage who is part of the plot. We know what is involved and who it is to be delivered to. And we know who the delivery boy is. The only thing left is, where is the stuff?
How much would it be worth to you to know?
No deals. We've been after you for a long time.
Don't you ask for it. I'm not going to be taken. You're still going over the side. And who'll be the wiser?
What's the matter, Mary?
Oh, that sounded like a shot, Chip.
Now, you just forget about everything except yourself.
All right, darling. Oh, I'm so sick.
Now, hold everything till I can get the door open. Now, the light. Mr. Braithwaite.
Oh. Just come in, both of you, and close the door.
What's the gun for?
Now, you heard me. Come in.
Yes, sir.
Oh, the man on the floor. That's the man who broke in. Look at his hand.
Yes, I surprised him, and unfortunately, I had to shoot him. I'm sorry this had to happen tonight of all nights.
But what was he looking for? I mean, now that everyone knows the Shaw isn't aboard and we're in this cabin.
Well, apparently our public relations didn't get to everyone. Now, look, I suggest that you go back down to your party and let me take care of this man.
Well, first off, Mary has to get a pill. She's suddenly come up seasick.
Let me take her down to the dispensary. We can help you in no time, Mrs. Chilton.
What about him?
Oh, we can leave him up to the authorities.
Well, we better make sure the door is locked. It was open when we came in.
From now on, we are going to make sure of a lot of things. Well, come along. Let's go, shall we?
You can all stop right there.
How did you get in?
The door was open. Drop the gun, Mr. Braithwaite.
Your gun against mine. Drop yours.
Caesar.
No! No!
Cut him off! Drop the gun.
Yes!
Down, Caesar, down.
Get over and lean on the wall. Hands over your head.
I can't. My hand is agonizing.
It's only bruised. Caesar didn't even break the skin. Go on, march. Mr. and Mrs. Shelton, sit down, please. No, over there on the couch.
Why, you can see.
You're not blind.
No, I'm not. I can get rid of these glasses now.
Who are you? What do you want?
Now, look. You make one move against Mary.
Relax, Mr. Shelton. I have nothing against you two. Only against that blubbering little crumb against the wall. Just let me check and make sure it's clean.
I'm not armed anymore. Please, can I take my hands down? The one your dog grabbed is killing me.
I only wish it were.
What is going on here? Mr. Braithwaite?
Why don't you ask the man with a gun?
Mr. Brucey, can I help?
No. No one can now. He's dead. He killed him.
Well, I caught him breaking into your cabin. He threatened me. I had to defend myself.
You slimy little worm. He wasn't armed.
Well, I had no way of knowing that.
I'd still like to know what this all is about.
Let me reintroduce myself. My name is Henry Bruce, Drug Enforcement FBI. The man this miserable creature shot was Sergeant Gino Mastiera, Naples Police. We've been working together trying to trap Mr. Braithwaite for smuggling drugs into the U.S. We suspect they are hidden in this suite of rooms.
Why would he hide drugs here?
Oh, he's a slippery little character with more ingenious ways to get around the law. This caper was a Lulu. The Shaw, who was supposed to travel in these staterooms, was, of course, above suspicion and had diplomatic immunity. The stuff would have gone ashore in his luggage.
You mean a head of state would smuggle?
No. One of his servants was the go-between, the one we got our information from. Once through customs, he'd have recovered it and made the delivery.
Only the Shaw canceled out.
And the drugs were already aboard. The break we got is that Braithwaite reneged on payment to the servant, so the guy blew the whistle on our purser. We wanted to make absolutely sure the drugs were on board, and of course we didn't know the suite had new occupants.
But if he was hiding heroin or whatever it is in here, why would he have given us the suite?
No, you were a gift from heaven, almost as good as the Shaw. No matter how well you packed, somehow the stuff would have found its way into your luggage and sailed through customs.
But how would he have gotten it back?
This little toad deals with some rough customers. They'd have turned up and taken it away. And probably you, too.
Oh, you mean...
He would have just thrown us to the wolves like that?
He had no second thoughts about shooting Gino in the back.
Now, just a minute. I don't know who this man is, but I wouldn't listen to this ridiculous nonsense, Mary and Jim. This nonsense about drugs and heroin.
Why don't you just show us where it is and save time and trouble?
You won't find a thing here.
I would,
if I could tear the place apart.
Oh, do you seriously think you could get such an authorization on such flimsy evidence?
You played your ace. Now let me trump it.
See there.
No.
Perhaps my little masquerade as a blind man seemed a bit much, but not when you know about Caesar. As well as an attack dog, he has been trained to sniff out heroin and cocaine. We've covered most of the boat, except this very private area. Now we'll do that, too.
Caesar?
Go find it, boy. Go find it. And don't think he won't. Jim, Mary, at least the last few days turned out to be a honeymoon.
Thanks to you, Mr. Bruce. And Caesar.
I still can't believe it. How much heroin was behind that panel?
2.5 kilos. About $10 million worth.
Wow. And Braithwaite?
A first-degree murder will put him away for the rest of his life. The drug rap we might have had more trouble with. Small consolation to Gino. But at least he didn't die in vain.
I guess you saved our lives, too.
It's been a jolt for me. You know, I'm thinking of changing my mind about practicing criminal law.
One thing we cops can always use is a nice, smart, tough district attorney.
Few of us will run up against anything like Mary and Jim encountered. Yet, maybe there is a sort of message underneath all this. It is human nature to try to go through life leaving everything up to George. But sooner or later, the opportunity or the necessity develops. And if and when it does, shouldn't we be ready to put our shoulder to the wheel? I'll be back shortly. Braithwaite was indicted and convicted for first-degree murder. Henry Bruce was promoted for his work on this case. And Mary and Jim Shelton very shortly found themselves involved in another case history, just as crazy as the one they started married life with. The twins were easily named, Henry for the boy and Jean after Gino. Our cast included Jada Rowland, Russell Horton, Ian Martin, and Gordon Heath. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
Someone get the fire department. Looks like the bank's on fire. Well, do something, somebody. The Union Bank's just been blown up.
Mr. Pinkerton, we just got a wire from the American Bankers Association. Two men blew open one of their banks the night before last and got away with $28,000.
Who is the law there?
Oh, Tom Birch. He's the sheriff of Union.
Any word from him?
Well, a phone there. He's been sick for a week, so nobody's made up a posse.
And the robbers got away. Are they sure there were only two?
Yep. And made a mess of Main Street between them.
All right, CJ, it's your case. Find those two robbers and find them good.
Not fast.
Yep. Find them good and fast.
Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Buick Motor Division and ARM, Allergy Relief Medicine. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.